I am inviting my friend Shannon, who is, hi Shannon.
Hi.
How are you? I don't know what we're doing on the first time.
I know, I don't know. I'm sorry about that.
So, why are we talking today?
We are talking to spread the word about intuitive eating and what dieting does, what our goal is with what we're trying to promote with our course.
Yeah, so Shannon and I are doing a 3-week online course about mixing intuitive eating, the principles of intuitive eating, with the tools of our spiritual practice. And so when I met you a year ago, I didn't know anything about intuitive eating. And I was talking to you, I was like, yeah, I kind of intuitively eat. Like sometimes I'll do the keto diet because I feel like I want more, you know, like less carbs. And then sometimes I feel like I need more carbs. So I'll just go like, you know, vegetarian for a while. And you're like, I don't think you really get it.
So. Like that is not intuitive eating. That's following a diet.
So,
so many people do that. It's like such this, sometimes like this, like the keto is like, I'm following a diet, and vegetarian can be a lifestyle, but it's kind of looking at the reasonings why.
Let's talk about the difference of like lifestyle versus diet. And then like, what if, so like Adam and I are gluten-free, we're kind of like gluten light right now because he was in the hospital and they told him that for his gout, he should cut out the inflammatory foods. And so that's something that we're trying to kind of do, but we're trying to, because we also know about intuitive eating. So tell me like, what's the difference between a lifestyle and a diet?
Well, so intuitive eating, it's, I mean, there's a big part where you're looking at taking in like the attunement. So like hunger, fullness, satiation, but it's also honoring health value. So if we use Adam as an example, because it's a great example of looking at like, he has this inflammatory disease, if you will, that he has to be watchful of those certain foods that would cause more inflammation. So there, that we would look at, that's a health value. And so let's say it's whether like, is he valuing that part? Is he going to value the fact that like, okay, gluten does have a response to him, like that does cause there to be more gout and more inflammation. So is he going to value that? So then it's looking at the emotional response around that. So if you, I mean, I see a lot of people who might have autoimmune disease or certain issues where they have to be watchful with food, but that can be kind of when people kind of go like, F it, I don't care, I'm going to go ahead and have this. And then they're in chronic pain. It's looking at like, okay, we have to step back and look at, why are you doing that to yourself? Like there is, that's where like this worthiness comes in and how you are treating your body, how you feel about your body, and healing this relationship with food of looking at like the data that your body gives you is that your body does not do well with this food. So can we look at that as data and really process that versus it being like, I can't have it and I want to rebel against it. Because when we've been a dieter, it's like you've just been handed a rule. And so then it's like, oh, I don't want to have to do that. So it's really looking at the healing process and look, putting it in terms of, but how, what information is your body giving you that's like, treat me kindly. Please give me these foods that make my body feel good versus hurt or rebel.
It's almost like a lifestyle. The motivation behind a lifestyle is almost a little bit more mindful just inherently than the motivation of a diet, because a diet, usually people who are fad dieters like me, I was like, oh, I want to take off 10 pounds or I want to do that, or I'm going to, you know, I'm going to be doing a live event. So I want to make sure I look trim and fit.
Right. And yeah.
So let's talk about like that kind of dieting and let's talk about the pros and cons of it, if you will. If there are any, if there are any pros, tell us about those. And if there aren't, tell us about the cons.
Well, there's not many pros. I mean, the pro can be that it does work. I mean, the pro is that that sort of dieting does work. So in the respect of like, will you lose weight? Yes. But the backlash of that is that's the con. And that outweighs the pro in the fact that like by doing that sort of thing, like you're screwing up your metabolism because often you're restricting so much that you put your body into like this starvation famine mode that then when you go and eat, you tend to be more bingy. You tend to be over indulgent or you're just overeating because you've just gone through famine. So that's like the natural primal response is to be like, gimme, 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 gimme. And so then the tendency of what happens is because your body, I mean, we're not too far removed from the generations where that was a legitimate thing of your body being in famine. So the, what your body does is goes into storage mode. Its process will be to overproduce fatty tissue as a protective mechanism. So all the weight that you lost, and really when you're doing like these like one hit diets like that for an event, a lot of what you lose is water weight. So part of that is like you gain all that back plus additional weight.
Right. You know? My go-to was the cabbage soup diet, which is like cabbage soup like for like 10 days or something.
Right. Something awful.
And then you're adding in these strange things like all the steak and tomatoes you can eat on one day.
Yes.
And then one day is just bananas and milk. And by the time I'm done with it, I think, you know, I lost like 10 pounds every time, but it was mostly water weight probably because of all the cabbage. But then also I would be like, all right, I'm going to eat whatever I want now, like order me three pizzas and get those.
Right. Well, yeah. And that's such a great, because it creates this response to these foods. So now like you look at like your response is I want pizza. So then pizza almost gets this to be demonized. It's like this forbidden food that I'm now not to have. And then it's like, well, look at how I am with pizza. I can't have pizza. I can't have this food because look at how much I eat with it, because there's not permission. And that part's such a key part when we look at healing this relationship with food, is you have to have permission with food. If I have permission, then I'm not in deprivation. And I have the allowance to have it when I want, and I can drop in and be mindful with how do I feel when I have this? What's bite one taste like? What's bite one compared to bite eight? Like, does it taste as good? Is there a point where I can say, this doesn't really taste that good, I don't want any more? But when I'm in deprivation, I am shoveling it all in my mouth. I'm totally eating so fast. And it's like, I'm eating it all because it's the only time I get it.
I remember when we first started having a conversation about intuitive eating like a year ago, and I was like, I don't understand how this could ever work for me, because if there's ever bread pudding in front of my face, I will eat all of it.
Right.
And I did, like, and we talked about the, you know, you were like, you have to give yourself permission. And I was like, okay, I give myself permission. I'm going to gain 30 pounds in a week. I know it. And I did give myself permission, but I learned that like, when you give yourself permission, then it takes the charge around that food away eventually, because
yes,
I had bread pudding like every day for 2.5 weeks. And right, then I was like, okay, well, I know that I can have it at any time that I want it, but I don't want it anymore because I'm kind of like
right,
over it.
Yeah. Well, and I think that part, you know, when we talk about it, it can seem so like simplistic of like, just give yourself permission, but there's so much anxiety that's behind it. You know, when we look at depending on how you were brought up and what rules were with food, how you were taught about food, that can trigger up a lot of stuff. So it can be like, that does not feel safe to do. So part of that is, you know, leaving lots of space for that and understanding like, okay, we have to slowly step. So I would by no means, if someone has like a lot of trauma around food or there was a lot of just rules, to sit and say like, go eat your worst forbidden food, you're not going to do it. Like that will cause there to be, that's not going to end well. So we would start with like, right, what's a food that maybe has less charge and work with that. And then we work our way up to see like, oh, okay, well then maybe I could try this and I could try that. So that's this delicacy, like, it's like that delicate balance.
Yeah. There is a lot of like all of this programming that we have. When we were talking about, for me, I remember like growing up and there was always that eat every bite on your plate, clean your plate.
Yes. Because
there are starving children in Africa.
Yes.
And I remember
that aren't going to eat what's on your plate.
Right. Right. I remember saying to my mom, I was like, well, then box this up and send it to them.
You're
like,
oh, right. Yeah.
But you know, if that is your mindset and if that's what you've been taught, that you have to clean your plate, then right, I think a lot of people would be like, well, if I have to clean my plate, then I'm going to have a salad because I can justify eating a whole salad, but I
yeah,
can't justify eating like a steak and a potato or something.
Yeah. Well, you know, and that is because that's like you're taught like the value of the food dollar. And it's not to dismiss that. I mean, there is value to that. And it's easy to be like, things can be dismissed or not dismissed. Things can be like where if you're taught this is what you must do because we're poor or we have to make sure that you're eating all, we can't waste this. Like that's imprinted on you. So
yeah,
then when you go, it's like, well, I have to eat all of this. If I'm going to eat out at a restaurant, I'm going to spend all this money. You bet I'm going to eat all of it. Or I'm going to go up 5 times to the buffet because look at all the money I just spent. So this is this part of where you have to keep that self-care and the self-worthiness really at the forefront of like, I am worthy to listen to my body when it tells me it's had enough. Like it's worth the $5, maybe $5, $10 I'm throwing away for me to stay in a kind place with my body. And it's helping to shift that mindset versus feeling like, well, I've spent all this money, I have to have all of it. Like it's this
because
shift.
There's so much guilt involved, right?
So much guilt, right? And you feel like, then if you feel too full, then it's the shame of, oh my God, I ate too much.
Right. It's like you have to eat it all because you're going to have guilt if you don't. And then afterwards, right. You're like, oh my God, why did
I have
eat
guilt?
That?
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
It's like a lose-lose situation.
Right. But that's the importance too of just uncovering like what was imprinted in childhood. I mean, we all know like adulthood's about healing from our childhood, and food is the same way. It plays out so much. So if like you've been told your body is wrong, you've been told your body is going to be wrong, you've been told these are what we have to do with food, if there's just been trauma around food, of course that's going to be played out as an adult. And that's where I feel like I'm very passionate about the space we're really trying to create, because it's really creating a safe space that we can all be together to help that healing process. Because when we're relating with community and relating of like, oh yeah, I felt that, or maybe it's not the same situation, but it's similar. It's like you're witnessed, you're seen, and it helps to take away some of that guilt and that shame.
Yeah, I think that's what's so interesting when we started talking, because I was like, I'm spiritual and I'm, you know, like I eat all of the stuff that you're supposed to eat, like, you know, green juice and smoothies, and I go to yoga 3 times a week, and I do these things which are like, you know, those are the things that you're supposed to do as a spiritual person.
Yep, your
but
detoxes.
If you look at those, right, all my fasts, I do a fast every week, I do a detox, you know, like no sugar this month.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I don't understand, like, why you don't understand me. Like, I'm a spiritual person. I am doing all the right tools for eating. And I totally didn't get it. But then when I stepped back and looked at the way that I was living my life in other areas and being so adamant about self-care and being so adamant about, you know, looking at what my needs are and setting boundaries for myself and not putting myself around toxic people and not, you know, like creating space for myself and just really listening to what I need.
Yeah.
But I wasn't doing that with my food. Like what? No. So I started thinking, why do spiritual people, you know, they got it under control. Like I see so many people that are like, I'm going to take off 3 weeks from social media because I don't need this. I got to go inward. I got to listen to what I need. But then they are doing like the kale and the green juice. It's like your body is not telling you that you want kale and green juice every day. I know it's not. I know you want some donuts and you want some bread pudding. Because right? Andrea said earlier, she's like, that's me with donuts. I think that, or pizza, right? Like, everybody wants a carb every now and then.
Well, because we need it. That's, I mean, as much carbs are so demonized right now, but like that's what your brain runs off of. Your central nervous system runs off of carbohydrates. And if you don't take them in, your body breaks down your muscle mass and turns it into carb to fuel your brain. So that's where you can go several days, but that's where then it's like, I want more. I want some. Ooh, that sounds so good. And it's like, no, but I have the willpower. I will fight it. It's all of that mindset that will totally set you up. So that's the importance of that allowance.
So tell me like in a nutshell, like what is, if intuitive eating isn't going to teach you like, this is what you should eat or this is what you shouldn't eat. Like what is like the simplest takeaway about like what somebody could expect to learn about intuitive eating?
So like intuitive eating will actually tell you what your body likes and what it doesn't. The difference is it's not dictated for you. It's not handed to you and it doesn't say like, here's your points, here's your macros, here's your calories, here's the foods that you should eat. It's listening. So it's turning in and listening to, okay, let's say, for example, I have a donut for breakfast. Okay, like, well, how do you feel? Like, do you feel energized? Do you feel tired? It might be, okay, I feel tired. So okay, if we look at that, could we throw a protein in with your donut? Like what if you threw in a smoothie? What if you threw in some eggs? How do you feel then? It's all about collecting data with foods and understanding what does hunger look like. Now, most people who do a lot of dieting, they know what that strong primal hunger of like ravenous hunger feels like. but they're not really sure what those edges are, like the, like what I call like the nudges of like, hey, I'm starting to get hungry. Like, that's not even coming on the radar until it's like, fade me. So it's being really, really curious of the data that your body gives you, and when is it saying that it's hungry, and what are these other signs you might experience of hunger? So it could be you're thinking a lot about food, you feel tired, you're more lethargic, like those can be signs. And then it's understanding like what's fullness like, and is your tendency to feel full but not satisfied? Have you ever felt satisfied but not full? Those are two really distinct qualities. And so ideally, we want you to feel like, I feel pleasantly full, but I feel satisfied. Like, that was what I wanted. So if I'm rolling into dinner and I'm eating chicken and broccoli, I'm kind of like, okay, what's next? I still need more. And so the tendency can be like going through the pantry and grabbing the cookies or getting the ice cream, or I've saved up so I can have all that because dinner kind of was crap. It really wasn't satiating, but like, I can have this. It's looking at that setup. So we really look at, with intuitive eating, like all these signals that your body is giving you, and the foods that make your body feel really energized and good. So like an intuitive eater, when you've done your work, is a really nutritious eater, because those are the foods that make your body feel really good. But like when you want the donut, when you want the cookie, when you want the pizza, you have it and it's done. There's no chatter of like, oh my God, I can't believe I had that. And so should I cut that out because I had that, and I should not have this tomorrow because I had that. There's none of that. It's like, wow, that was delicious. And I can end there.
And there's not so much judgment. So I see like a lot of people are like, well, I had a donut last night, so I'm going to hit the gym harder or do 30 right. minutes on the treadmill.
Right.
So it's almost yes. like you're punishing yourself for giving yourself what it wants.
Exactly. So like it's taking that part away. And like you brought up a great point too, with just the exercise, like it's figuring out, like it's not making exercise in this punitive way to punish your body for what it had last night or how the weekend went or even like for the size of it. The exercise is purely about the enjoyment while you're doing it as well as after. So people can kind of be like, well, I feel really good after, so that's why I do it. But it's like, well, if it's sucking the entire time that you're doing it, like that's not a healthful relationship with exercise. Like we want to create where it's like, wow, this is fun. I really like it. And so sometimes it's stepping outside of the box. So like for me, part of my journey with healing with intuitive eating was the exercise part. I mean, I had so much body stuff and how I looked and the attention I got for that. So I did a ton of weight training and would get a lot of attention for that. So when I was going through this process, I let go of it. I was like, my body hurts and I'm only doing it to change my body. So I just did yoga, which in my mind before, like did not count as exercise. So like that was like a nice off day thing that I did, but never was I going to do that as my routine. And I would walk because I loved walking and being outside in nature. But again, that was like an off day thing. And I stayed super curious and I would have like, oh God, what's going to happen to your body? And oh my God, how are you going to look at the pool? And how is this going to be? And all of like these old tapes that would go and go and go and go. But and so like, it's not going to be easy. Intuitive eating is not like this, I'm doing awesome. It's like, I'm doing great. And holy shit, I'm going down here. And then I'm over here. And then I'm over here. Like it's all zigzagging because that's the process of it. But what I found was so much just stillness and peacefulness of seeing like, wow, look at what my body can actually do. And I feel so mindful and I'm not judging anymore. And the same with the food stuff. Like, I mean, we all have our fair share of that stuff. And even though doing what I do, I still had food stuff, but not really realizing that it was there until I was like, oh, wait, I don't need to have protein here if I don't want to. I could just see how I feel. Like, do I feel okay here? Do I not? It's just being really curious with it and always having permission. Like I was I want ice cream all the time. Like that was kind of my family thing. Like my mom had a ice cream store when I was growing up. So it was like lots of familial like love and
yeah.
But like my husband would make fun of me all the time. He's like, you literally, like we get it and it's like gone in 5 minutes. Like I would never taste it. It was just like, oh my God, I get to have it. So just slowing that down and realizing like, wow, like sometimes I'm going to eat all of it. Sometimes I'm like, I feel fine after 5-6 bites and then I'm done. Like it's giving that permission and just being really aware and bringing consciousness to the unconscious behaviors with food. That's the healing that's there.
It's a lot, sounds a lot like what what a spiritual person would do when they're tuning in with meditation and they're going, yes. What do I need today? Do I need to take a break from social media? Do I need to not talk to my crazy cousin who triggers my old, you know, traumas? And do I need to take a break from that relationship mm-hmm. or that toxic work coworker?
Yeah.
All the kind of tools that we're implementing in our daily lives about tuning in and figuring out what we need to show up as the better person, as the better version of ourselves.
Yeah.
But it's so shocking that there's, like, who's doing that with food? Like, I know, sure as hell wasn't.
Right. I know. Well, and, you know, that's the part, like, that's part of, like, the, you know, being passionate about when there's the spiritual component. Like, I feel like I look at, for me, like, that was my missing link. That was what I was hungry for, and a lot of what my food stuff, body stuff was masking. So when I was uncovering the intuitive eating, I also then found spiritual. I mean, it inserted itself at the perfect time, and it was just like, oh, that's what I've been so hungry for. So now I feel so much better about my relationship with food and body, but now I'm filled. Like, I am so fulfilled now in a way that I never had been. So that was a big shift. But then on the flip of someone who already has that, the food stuff, I mean, it just operates in its own little bucket. Like, it's like, all this stuff is so great, but, like, this is how it needs to be. And I've seen it so many times. And, you know, the clients that I've worked with that have been more spiritual, they're like, how is this happening? Like, how do I have this? And I'm so aligned in this way, but I'm not aligned here. But, totally. You know, there's so much conditioning with how we're brought up. We live in a huge diet culture that there's so much morality about food, about our body, the weight stigma that exists. So, I mean, I think we're infiltrated with it in so many facets that's part of why it's so hard.
It is totally hard. I mean, I think that growing up as women, especially that they're, you know, like the airbrushed covers of magazines, yes, and all yep. of that. And then as a gay man, like we think that every guy has to look like the David, right?
Right.
And
right.
it's like, it's, and then like I was in entertainment for years and I was comparing that is literally an industry where you're comparing yourself with everybody.
Totally.
And yep. everybody else is comparing. That's what an audition is. Yeah. It's like, okay, who's yep. the best version, right?
Yep.
And I think that I've had so many body image issues since I was a kid because I grew up with scoliosis and I had to mm-hmm. wear a back brace in my high school years, which was like great. And that'll really boost your self-confidence.
Yes.
But yeah, there's so many. I used to teach theater in LA before I moved away. And one of my kids, all of those kids are now like on TV shows and hugely successful. And I love watching them. But one of my girls is a model. She does high end modeling and she posted a picture. And of course she's beautiful and everything, you know, there's probably airbrush too, even though she's beautiful. But somebody said in the comments, like, this must be one of those stretch skinny apps. And I was like, is that like, that must be a joke, right? So I went into the app store and I looked it up and there are pages of yeah. apps that you can get on your phone that will contour your body and uh-huh. make it look skinnier.
Oh,
and
do yeah.
And I'm like, are we seriously putting these phones in the hands of our little ones?
I know.
And they can go and look at that? I mean, it's all over everything. It's so sad.
It's so sad. I mean, that's the part I think, you know, and especially with having kids, it's like, that's what they're exposed to. I mean, even looking at like a kid's TV channel, we'll have weight loss supplements and I've lost this much size. So even at that young age, they're sent this message like size of your body must matter or I don't want to look like that. Like it's because there's this negative connotation when we live in a society of all shapes and sizes. So when you're taught like, oh, well, my body must not be okay because it's bigger. I mean, that part is a really impactful thing. So you grow up with this message of like, my body's never enough. So I have to change it. I must do it. But what happens because of dieting, your body actually becomes bigger and bigger and bigger because you don't realize that you're actually messing it up. But that becomes like the worst thing possible. Like it's really looking at how demonized being in a bigger body is or being fat, the word fat, all of that. Like it's just really looking at how that's thrown around.
Well, and it's so cultural too, because it, like different ancient societies, being in a bigger body was better because it was a sign of affluence, right? And if
yes.
you were skinnier, you didn't have enough money to buy the good, rich food. But not only in culture, in society, in magazines, on apps, on TV shows, I think it's being bombarded to all of us. But I think that we also have to look at how we're talking in our own vernacular in front of our kids. Like we look in the mirror and we go like, oh my God, I'm so fat. I need to lose some weight. And we're saying that in front of our 12-year-old
little sponges.
Daughter.
Yeah.
And then they're going like, oh my God, do I need to, you know? So it's like,
well, yeah. And it's even being aware of, like, I can't tell you how many clients I have that will say like, my mom never made a comment about herself, but she did about other people. So like, and it's just being aware of like, you're surrounded by it. Like it may not even be a conversation that you're having, but that's certainly being aware of like, just like you said, like, what are the comments about your body? Is there a lot of focus about how your body looks, how you look in those pants, how you look in that dress, how you look in those jeans? Like it's really being aware of what is coming out of your mouth versus like what your body can do and how great, like it's such this shift, but like when we're bombarded with like, be thinner, be fitter, be this, be that. It's almost like an instinct to be like, well, how do I look versus like to then think about like, well, what did my body do for me today? It's like, oh, well, what did it do? I was sad. I did this. I did that. Like, it's not, it's like we take all that stuff for granted.
It woke up.
Yeah. Right.
And you know what? I grew up in the South where everybody is like, it's a rule that if, as long as you follow up any insult with bless your little heart or bless her little heart, then it's totally
it's okay.
It's not a sin or anything. But you know, like I can just remember like even people come in and say, are you okay, honey? You look like you put on a few pounds. Bless you.
Yes. Heart.
Okay. You know, like that kind of thing. And even that, like that's a wound, right? That's like a, and it's so, that judgment is just so pervasive everywhere.
Yeah. Well, or even the comment of like, oh, have you lost weight?
Oh, right.
You,
like,
look,
that's,
you look great.
That's supposed to be a compliment.
That's a compliment. It's like, well, what did I look like before? Like it's, but that's, it, and what, like that's the commentary. The commentary is always about looks and body versus like, wow, you look so happy. Or what's going on? You don't look like, you look sad. Like, you know, it's just coming at it in such a different way. And I think, you know, that's the message. It's like, that's the light of wanting to spread of like, we have to heal. We have to heal. And the more of us that are healed, the more that we can spread the light of like, it doesn't have to be about how you look and we can have a peaceful relationship with food and body. Like all of that can be there, but it's bringing awareness to what you're doing.
Totally. Again, I bring this back to like our spiritual practice, because if we were to go up to somebody and say, you look a little judgmental today.
You know? Right.
Or you look like you haven't meditated in a week.
Right.
You know, like that is not okay. Nobody would ever think that was okay to make a judgment like that about somebody else.
Right.
Or you know, like to be, to judge yourself and be like, oh my God, I haven't done yoga in like 6 days. I am not mind body connected. You know,
right.
And I'm sure that does happen because we judge ourselves all the time. But, you know, to take that and say, you know, like, oh, I haven't seen this person in yoga for 6 days. They must be backslidden off of their spiritual path or whatever. You know, like it's just, it doesn't show up as pervasive to me anywhere else around any other area of life except for body image and food.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I found that people are like mostly funky about some crazy whacked out money beliefs, crazy whacked out body beliefs, and crazy whacked out food beliefs.
Yeah.
I think it's like 100%. The biggest things in our culture.
Yeah. Well, and you know, you kind of look at like how much those can all be intertwined. Like someone who's kind of weird about food is kind of all then also weird about money. It's like the restriction, the binging, you know, they can kind of insert themselves quite,
true.
I mean, that happens quite a bit. So it's, but that's this part, you know, when we kind of look at the body and the food stuff, it's really looking at like, what are, like, are you getting like your basic needs met? Are you getting, like, are you taking good care of yourself? And then, like, what are your belief systems about food? What are your belief systems about your body? I mean, those are questions that people don't ask themselves. And that's the deeper work. And it's not, I mean, some of it can be pretty, like, it's a lot of work. But it doesn't have to be that degree if you don't want it to be. But I could tell you, like, from doing some of the work, you're going to get a lot further than just going on the next diet or counting your, living in, like, macro jail or keto or, you know, whatever the next thing that you want to try. I mean, that's not going to be the answer.
It's like when anybody says, oh, I can't sit for 20 minutes and meditate a day. That's too much. It's so hard. But then they do it for like 2 weeks and they're like, oh my God, I have to do more of this because I feel so much more clarity. I feel so much more peace, so much more calm and quiet on the inside. Right. So it's the same thing. I feel like would it be safe to say intuitive eating is a spiritual practice?
I think so. I mean, I really have found that those two that's why it's just such a seamless joining, because I just feel like they go hand in hand, because you're just really discovering more about your true authentic you, and you find you. Like we look at like the dieting and fitness industry is like a hobby. It's like, well, what do? I count my macros and I go to the gym. Like, that's what I do. Like, I have clients that are like dating and they're like, oh my God, that's all I have to say that I do. Like, this is awful. Like, it's looking at that. It fills so much space. And so then to uncover that space, that sometimes can feel really scary of like, well, what's going to be under there? Well, what if I don't know? What if I'm boring? What if I'm this? What if I'm that? And that's that spiritual thing of like, it's all there. You just get to uncover it and rediscover or discover all these new parts of you that give you so much more fulfillment than I'm counting how much of this I have or I'm weighing this or whatever. You know, it's just such this amazing, beautiful shift that happens.
There was something else I wanted to talk about too, was I love to eat when I'm just like binge watching Netflix. And sometimes I'll be eating because it's like, it's just fun. Like, I feel like I'm at the movies, I'm having popcorn or I'm having, you know, like a piece of cake, because I'm more of a sweets person. So Adam has his popcorn and I have my cake. And, but I'm like, am I hungry really? Or am I just doing this because I'm like zoning out and I'm bored?
Yeah.
Is that like a form of emotional eating?
It can be. I mean, part of food can insert itself to kind of fill space when you're bored. It's looking at like, is there more of like a sensory thing? Like you need something to be like in your mouth or that you're chewing something. Is it part of the ritual of like, when I watch Netflix, I will always eat? Like, it's kind of looking at the experience of it. Some of that you have to look at, like, it's not to sit and like go through everything with a fine tooth comb of like, no, you can't do that. Like, some of that's like, that's fun. Like, I want to sit with my cake and watch my show because it's fun. So I think part of that is like it, but it's acknowledging the space that it's holding. It's like, well, it's part of the experience and that's what I like. Does it feel like it's getting in the way with anything? Am I walking away from that experience like, oh my God, I ate that whole entire piece of cake and I'm in my head? Or does it end when the show ends? Like, it's kind of looking at the charge that's around it, you know? So like, I have some clients where like them coming home, them watching TV and eating, it's all a part of the ritual. And so when I ask them like, well, would you want to eat that? Like, what if you just ate that at the counter or you ate that at the kitchen table? It's like, well, then I don't want it. It's like, okay, well then let's look at that. Like, what would it be like to show up in that situation and not have food? Is it really uncomfortable? So then we start to look at like what space the food is really holding. Is it more emotional? Is it just part of like what I like? Is it kind of my way of escaping and numbing? It's all understanding that.
It's like looking at your belief systems, looking at your patterns, looking at your history, looking at what would happen if you didn't do this, what would happen if you did, increasing your curiosity factor, which is all of the same stuff that we're doing in our spiritual path anyway, which is why I think that us doing this 3-week course is awesome. Like, one of the things that we're doing together is teaching EFT as an alternative of emotional eating. So instead of, you know, like, oh my God, my boyfriend broke up with me, I'm going to go have a tub of ice cream by myself, don't talk to me for 3 hours. And then going, okay, well, is that maybe the healthiest thing for me? Maybe let me just look at what I'm charged and what's my most pressing issue and tap that down using EFT. And then how am I feeling now? Maybe I feel totally better and I want to go out for a walk. Or maybe, you know what, I feel like hell still and I want to have the ice cream and I'm going to give myself permission to still have the ice cream.
Exactly. Well, that's the part, is like these tools I think are so important, because it's all about just creating space of helping to ride out that crest. Like when you're so heightened, it's like, oh my God, I can't feel this. And I just want to shove all this food in my face because I can feel like this ice cream hug that's just like, oh, I'm escaping. Or just the action of the binge. It's just, it, you know, it overtakes you. So if we kind of can create more space, we still might go for the ice cream, but it's probably going to be a little bit less. I'm not going to be as charged going into it. So it's a great tool because, you know, when we look at some of the therapeutic models that are given of like, call a friend, write in a journal. Sometimes it'd be like, well, I freaking don't want to do that. But I could sit here and just sit and tap because I don't have to move except my arm. Like, it's a great tool to insert to help.
Yeah, Totally. Yeah. Because you can isolate and tap at the same time.
Yes. Totally.
I totally give you permission to isolate as long as you're doing EFT at the same time.
Right.
Well, I'm so excited about our course coming up, and I hope
that this conversation
has been kind of informative to people and let people know kind of what our approach is going to be as we're exploring, learning more about yourself and learning more about your beliefs and learning more about how to integrate your spiritual tools into your, into like the areas of body and food.
Yeah. Yeah. And vice versa. Like looking at the spirituality coming into, like, if you feel like you're doing, like, food's going okay, but something's missing, like the tools of spirituality, it's just seamless. Yeah.
It's like when I was a little kid, we used to do the, here's the church, here's this, wait, yeah. here's the church, here's the steeple, open the doors and there's other people.
Yeah.
It's like that. They just integrate so well.
It integrates perfectly.
Well, I'm super excited about it. Let's tell people what's happening. We're having a 3-week online course. It's totally online. It begins next week, but the cart is open until when? Monday. Monday the 9th.
Monday the 9th. So we start on the 12th.
Yes. So go to www. And when I'm done with this, I'll put it in the comments, but www.valwhite.com/intuitive-eating.
Yeah.
And you'll find all the information there. It'll tell you what we're going to cover. It'll tell you, it'll give you a little bit of Shannon's outlook. There's a little note from Shannon. There's a little note from me telling you a little bit about my story, and it's a great price. It's, I don't even remember what it's, $278 for three weeks, and you get, there's a payment plan. So it's like
there's
a
payment plan. Yeah. And part of why we want the cart to close on Monday is because we want to send out work. So to give you a couple days before that Thursday to prep, because each week you'll get some coursework, not anything crazy, but just helping you to be more reflective and kind of go in and to look at that. So that's part of our purpose with
so that when we have our call, we have, you already have exactly, you know what we're going to talk about, and we can talk about what came up for you during the week with that coursework, and
yeah,
we'll have a really good Q&A session. I love the Q&As. I think all the magic
is
in the Q&As.
It is. So true.
So yeah, I think it's amazing. Also to say, you get this stuff forever. You will get replays of this, and you have the coursework and the replays to listen to over and over. So if you ever feel like I need a little pick me up, then you can always go back and replay it. So all right. I'm so excited.
Great.
And I
hope that these people
come and join us, because I want to give them all hugs.
I know. I hope so too. There's so much healing that can happen. And it just provides just a different way of looking at it and helping to end the struggle and the inner turmoil, that there can be so much peace that's there.
I know that I've like totally, having this conversation for a year has totally changed the way that I think about my body and the way that I look at food. And it's totally crazy.
Yeah, it is.
All right, my love. Well, thank you so much for having a conversation with me this morning.
Yes, great. Always talking to you. I love it.
All right. I will talk to you soon.
Sounds great.
Bye.
Bye.